Salam alaikum. I would like to start with a declaration. I'm very honored to be here with you, and I am very grateful for the invitation and also for the warm hospitality that has been offered to us, and that makes me feel exactly in my communities. I come from Peru. My name is Jorge Ishizawa. It's a country which has many things, similarities with Iran. It's a place of high mountains, and it's also a center of origin of agriculture. And also, of course, is the site of a large agro-biodiversity or diversity itself. I was trained as a civil engineer, so I'll take that engineering bashing that went on this morning. But I didn't do civil engineering professionally. What I did from the start almost was to work in agricultural development projects as in the planning side of it, actually, which reveals what planning is like. You know nothing of the contents, but still you rule or try to rule. My work then was centered on the agricultural field, but it's only relatively recent. Recently, 15 years ago, that I started working on the traditional agriculture that has been there in place for, some say, more than 8,000 years. So this Central Andes are a privileged place as a repository of agricultural knowledge. And yet, the university then and now does not have a place for native agriculture. Now, you can ask yourself why. It's not only in Peru that this is going on. I think it's absolutely all over the place. Please, I would like to know if there is a country where universities teach native agriculture. We started as a result of the failure of development projects such as those that we used to plan. And I was fortunate to find a community that was already a community of technicians who were already trying to do this in 1993. At the moment, they were running a course which I took and had been collecting agricultural practices since 1987. It was in the form of small booklets, technological practices, they call them, technological booklets. And what it did was a short description of practices of traditional agriculture, taken as testimonies from peasants in communities. And the thing is that trying to make a sort of a discourse on this traditional agriculture, it was not possible to do it from our technical background because it went beyond and needed a context, which fortunately then we found that it was the proper, the cosmovisions of the communities, how they understood agriculture, but on their own basis and on their own practice. So we had to give up all professional expertise because we had none in that condition. That was actually very fortunate because we learned quite a bit. And especially because at the center of this type of agriculture was community. So looking for agricultural practices, we found a living community of farmers or practitioners of traditional agriculture. And and it's interesting, I'll stress the translators in this, because there is in both of the major native languages, which are belong to oral cultures, in the high Andes, the Quechua language and the Aymara language, they both have the same word for community. It's ayu, that's the way it's pronounced, ayu. It's spelled A-Y-L-L-U. In Spanish, double L is has the sound of a y. The interesting thing about this community is that it not only includes humans, but also natural entities like rivers, lakes, mountains, and also deities, that is the divinities, which are not neatly separated one from the other because they all have, they all share characteristics. And another thing is that agriculture practiced by this community has the characteristic of nurturance. It means the relationship is mutual nurturance. It's not only that a farmer nurtures a plant, like a potato plant, but also feels that the potato plant is nurturing him or her. This makes for values in this, to call it some way, that are very important in community life. One of them is this affection that goes with nurturance and also respect. This is central in the Andean way of life. The idea of a world that is, that goes on or that lives because there is affection and there is respect. Fortunately here, Munir has talked about the word yusen,
is it all right?
As in Arabic, meaning the worth of a person. And one of the five characteristics of what this word means is to be respectful, or to do everything with respect. And so when you look at all this traditional agriculture that you find in the Andes, from this point of view, there is a reason to understand why there is such a tremendous biodiversity, not the natural biodiversity, the biodiversity nurtured by nature itself, or as the Andeans say, by the mountain deities. But it refers to agrobiodiversity, that is cultivated diversity. The Altiplano area that is shared by Bolivia and Peru, and in around the Titicaca Lake, if you know something of the geography there, we have a big lake there, and this is the Titicaca Lake. Is the reputedly the place in the earth which has the largest agrobiodiversity, both in terms of species diversity and also the variability within each species, the intra-specific diversity. Well, I'm telling you all this story because what we found is that there was a reason to go back to this wisdom that you find in the communities to try to build knowledge for yourself, to accompany these communities and to carry on these programs of recovering agrobiodiversity or of finding ways of doing intercultural education, you can rely on the opinion or the views of the community. For instance, one of the things we found is the importance of, the first thing was basing on their own cosmovision. That's the way they related to the world. In one of the programs regarding education in 2000, I think, we found this, that the problem or the diagnosis of the problem, the educational problem of the moment, was the generalized loss of respect that school has brought to the communities. And this loss of respect, not only among humans, but towards nature and to deities, was considered the major problem. Now, the question is that we found this again, once and again, when we looked at some initiatives that the communities had undertaken, and we found that, for instance, in the case of the climate change, the initiatives that the community had recommended and undertaken came to 82% of the total of initiatives. They all related to climate change, which is the most global sign of loss of respect. Now, that's for academics. Could we develop a science that is not based exclusively on greenhouse gases emissions, but on loss of respect? I think this is a more encompassing diagnosis, and that we owe to the communities. And we there find the problems of having a disciplinary organization of knowledge, which we in academia nurture. I'll leave it at that. Thank you.